forgot your name. What's your name again? Abdul. Abdul asked me that to explain a little bit in again convolution integral. Are other people also having difficult time understanding convolution? If you are, I can spend a few minutes on that. Okay, because it's a very very important part of not just how to find structural response of a structure to excitations. It would be very important when we go to flutter, because all aerodynamics response, aerodynamics calculations are also based on the same ideas of convolution, except that in that case applied to aerodynamics. Okay, so I'm going to go over that again a little bit. So let's suppose we go back to our equation mx double dot plus cx dot plus kx equal to f of t. Okay, f of t is the applied load, and let's suppose it looks like something like this. This is my f of t. The basic idea, I'm going to draw two very similar, because then I'm also going to answer the question the other method. So even though they don't look same, but they are same. Okay. So think of in convolution, what we say is, let's suppose for this system mx double dot plus cx dot plus kx, I have found the response. You can either call it delta t response to I delta t. I delta t, as we talked about, is an impulse whose magnitude is 1, but if you write that in terms of force versus delta t, it is a force which is going to infinity, but its duration delta t going towards 0. So that the area under the curve is 1, that is called unit impulse. Okay. So that very large force applied over an extremely short time, very large approaching 0 and extremely short approaching, no, very large approaching infinity and the very short approaching 0, but the area under the curve remaining finite. Okay. So when we do that, and it's done very quickly, very, I mean, you don't even, you can't even, let's suppose, see how much time it takes. It's so small. After you have applied the impulse, that impulse of magnitude 1, there are two ways to look at it. We said one is to put this as a forcing function over here, but let the initial velocities go to 0, initial displacement go to 0. That's if you want to use Laplace transform method. That's one way of doing that. The second way of doing that is, because it happens so suddenly, I really don't care much about what happens between time 0 to the time impulse ended. What I'm interested in is, what's the impulse was imparted, what happened to my system? What happens to your system is essentially you end up giving an initial velocity to your mass. Okay. So that initial velocity, so you can, the way to look at it is a slightly better way, not a, I mean, the only way is approach, assume that as if the right hand side was 0, but you have x dot at 0 equal to 1 over m. You guys with me? And x 0 equal to 0. So that response of a system, whatever system you have, to this kind of initial condition, you can think of it as response to an impulse. Okay. And it, for our case, it came out to be, we represented by h over t, and it came out to be 1 over m omega d sine omega d into t. That it came out to be that. Remember that? Okay. Now, this is my, think of this now as a building block. Think of this as a building block. So you can assume, going, go back to your knowledge of calculus. What do we do in calculus? We, if I ask you to find integral of a function, you can think of it as a sum of infinite areas, right? You would say, if this, if I want to integrate something, I can think of it as something like this, something like that, something like this. I calculate areas of all these little rectangles and I add them up. If this time delta t approaches 0, that summation becomes integral. I mean, that's the basic idea of integral, that you are essentially, what you are doing is you are getting area under a curve, And because you are getting area under a curve, one way to look at it is sum of infinite number of rectangles, which are very easy to find response of. All you will do is f at some tau multiplied by delta tau, that is the area under at that point. And as, or I can write f I, and I goes from 1 to n, as n approaches infinity, that this becomes then f of t dt from a to b. Okay. So, what I want to do now is I want to find response of this system under f of t. So, what we say is, let us suppose, forget about what actual f of t is, at time t I apply an impulse, and the magnitude of that impulse at would be at first time would be f at 0 into delta tau. Okay. So, that is the impulse I have applied, and based on that impulse I would have a response at any t, which would be equal to 1 over m omega d sin omega d t, okay, because I am applying at t equal to 0. Then what I am going to do is I would apply another impulse at time delta tau now. Okay, I apply another impulse and response, I am going to call this one h 1, because that is my first impulse, and this is going to last forever. Okay, it is going to last forever. Then at delta tau I apply another impulse, that would be h of tau h 2 at some t is, let us say, somewhere over here. Okay, that would be again 1 over m omega d into sin omega d into t minus delta tau, because the impulse was applied at delta tau, but I am still measuring the response at time t. Okay. So, if I have applied only those two impulses at time t, what would be my response? Let us suppose the force end over here, what would be my response at this time? I just add them up, right. And but then what I am doing is I apply a third impulse, this time at 2 delta tau, and I get my h 3 t, which would be again 1 over m omega d sin omega d t minus 2 delta tau.
Can I write would be equal to sum I going from 1 to some number as many I have applied till I reach the value of t. Instead of calling them, I would simply call them h I t. Can I say that? Okay. And this we can also write equal to I goes from 1 to n, 1 over m omega d into sine. Back to this notion of integral becoming, when sum of some quantities go to infinity, we replace that sum to sum by an integral. So, doing as n approaches infinity, xpt becomes integral going from 0 to t, I made one mistake here, come back over here. I need to multiply each one of them with f I delta tau, because those are my, so that's the impulse I'm applying. I'm not applying unique impulse. When I was at t equal to 0, the impulse I applied was f 0 into delta tau, right? When I was here, the impulse I applied was, if this value was f 1, it was f at delta tau into delta tau.
You see what I'm saying? So coming back over here then, and I should go back over here, and I should call them impulse, what should I call them, fi delta tau, oh, we can call them fi delta tau. Okay. So now this whole thing is our impulse response at time t for something if we applied our impulse at tau. That's what this is. Okay. So the other way I have to look at it is, if I was somewhere here at time tau, I apply this impulse, what would be my response at this point? Okay. That would be, if the magnitude of impulse was f at that tau into delta tau, that was my impulse over there, and the response over here due to that would be h at t when the impulse was applied at tau multiplied with f of tau into d tau. This is the response due to this guy at this point. Make sense, right? So if I multiply it, if I integrate now, what I'm saying is, take response of this over here, take response of one before that, all the way, as many impulses you have applied up to that point, add them up. And because delta tau is approaching 0, that summation is going to become integral. Okay. So that's where this integral comes from, that this is the response due to an impulse of magnitude f tau d tau applied at t equal to tau, and I have applied infinite number of those, because in the limit delta tau is going to 0. So because I have applied all of them, and I have to add response due to every one of them, and that sum becomes our integral. And this response, this integral is called convolution integral. I mean, that's just a name, and it's represented as f t star h t. That's just again a symbol. So if you hear the word convolution integral, that's all they are saying. Like I said, it's a very, very important concept, both for flutter in aerodynamics calculations and in structural dynamics calculations. So you should be, and in control theory, okay. In that also, there also you use it a lot. There it goes under the name of state transition matrix. Because you're dealing with more than one degree of freedom. Here we are dealing with just one degree of freedom, so I have h t minus. Okay, so that's one way of doing it. That's one way of doing it. The other one, and you can show they are related to each other. Okay, the other one is, think of your forcing function as apply what we call a Heaviside function. Okay, it's represented as u of t. U of t is a function which is 1 at t equal to 0 and after, but before that it's 0. Okay. So this is, it's called Heaviside function, and it is represented as let's say apply it at some time tau again, just so it would be 0 to 1, this value would be 1, and then it's going to stay 1 forever. Now coming back to our system, again, mx double dot plus cx dot plus kx equal to, So apply at t equal to 0 this u of t, that means t equal to 0, you will apply this at t equal to 0 first. And you find the response and put some magnitude in front of it if you want to, but does not matter because you can all, it is a linear system. If you get the response for a unit value, you can multiply with any constant and that would be response for that value, right. So let us suppose you do this and just like you got h of t, you could also get response this. Again, the best way to do is Laplace transform, because Laplace transform of u of t is 1 over s, and then you can do 1 over s into 1 over m s square plus k s plus s t and all that, you can very easily do that, okay. And it is given in any book on structural dynamics. So let us represent that x of t then as a of t. So just like I said h of t before, impulse response function, think of a as response to a Heaviside function applied at t equal to 0. So if I apply the response, the excitation at time tau, then, and let us say this is how A looks like. Let us say this is how A looks like, okay, that is the generally, that is how they look like generally, that essentially they reach the value of steady state, but they take some time to reach there, okay, they generally take some time to reach there, and then they also start to oscillate around the steady state value. So due to this, I won't have any response before that. So before then, this would become my a of t minus tau. Wherever you would see t, you simply replace it with t minus tau. Okay. So what you would do then is, coming back over here, you would first find the response to a Heaviside function applied at t equal to 0 and whose value is f 0, because the forcing function here is f at 0, right, that is the value f 0. So when I do that, the first response I would get would be equal to, so my x p t would be now equal to f applied at 0 into a that is if I apply a constant force f 0 and leave it there, okay. But that is not what I am doing. What I am doing is at time, let us say go back to time delta tau again, I am applying another additional Heaviside function. What is the magnitude of that additional Heaviside function? You could say that, right, f 1, if I call it f 1 or minus f 0, or I could simply call it, I can draw a straight line from here, that would give me df over dt multiplied by delta t and add it, right. So I could say this additional Heaviside function I have applied can be written as df over dt times delta t. Can I say that? Because we are talking about very, very small values I should say delta tau. Okay. So I have applied another Heaviside function at t equal to delta tau. So what would that do to us? What would be the impact of that additional excitation I have given to the system? Add, right. So that would be df over dt into delta tau, that is the magnitude of our additional Heaviside function. And what would I do for A now? T minus delta tau. Okay. But I am not stopping there. I am going to go back over here and now I am going to do another one. I'm going to do another one now. And that gives me plus df over dt. This one was at t equal to 0. This one would be at t equal to delta tau, and times delta tau into a into t minus 2 delta tau. And I will keep on doing that. Okay, I'm going to keep on doing that. So, if I apply the Heaviside function over here, our response would be then x p tau, then can t can be written as, let's see what does this does. A Heaviside function applied over here would give me a response of a into t minus tau into the value of whatever the value is applied at that time, but we are not doing that. What we are doing is instead this. Okay, so what we would get then is f, first term does not change. Okay, that term would stay as it is, f of 0 into a of t, and for the rest of them we go from 0 to whatever t we have, df over dt into a t minus tau into delta tau. Okay, so these are the two ways to calculate particular integral, and you can perform integration by parts either on this one or on the other one. You can show that how you can get one from the other. Did I answer your question, Abdul? Did I answer your question? Okay. So that they are both called convolution integral, but generally when people say convolution integral, they mean due to impulse response function. And again, this book on theory of elasticity on page, actually any book, it's interesting, it came right there, page opened up 278, 279, it gives pretty good description of that. Okay, so see, it's applying an impulse of, I mean, unit function of df over dt d tau into delta tau, right? And this is the response because of that, and then you simply add all the responses, and they have even calculated what the response a of t is in this book. So a of t is no, they have not. Well, they just simply give this formula. It could be obtained from 1 over 2 pi, but I think the best way to do really is through Laplace transform. You can really, you can do it easily from Laplace transform. Somewhere it must have given the actual value of a of t. Oh, here it is. Here it is. 1 over omega z square, omega 0 square, 1 minus cosine omega dt. See, when omega is 0, when t is 0, you start with 0, right? But then it starts to oscillate around the value 1. See this? So this is the value of a of t, and this is what we derived last time in class. Delta due to delta t, we got somebody here. Yeah, this is what we derived: 1 over omega 0 sine omega 0 t. Well, they are not. See, in his case, m is not there. He's not having that M over there. I have a suspicion this is incorrect. It should be M here also. Okay. This should not be 1 over omega 0 square, it should be 1 over M omega 0 square. Or their M might be included in one itself, this symbol itself, you know, because this omega 0 square you get when you divide both sides with M. Okay, so they didn't have it on the right hand side, so that is why in their case that M does not show up, but my suspicion is it is part of this symbol of 1 over t. I mean, then it is correct. If otherwise in our case it was what we called 1 t, we call it 1 over m. Okay, and then that m is missing, so it is correct as long as you keep that in mind. So that is why when you read from books you have to still be very careful what the way they are representing things. Different books represent things differently. It is also called Duhamel's integral. This is Duhamel's integral. We call it convolution or Duhamel, same thing. Make sense, guys? Okay, very good. So what I want to do next is now let's talk a little bit about control effectiveness. Okay, so let's talk about control effectiveness. So once again, we will start with a very simple example. Anyone want to tell what do we mean by loss of control effectiveness due to aeroelasticity? We did discuss that on the first day when we were trying to do introduction to aeroelasticity. What did we say about control effectiveness? What happens in control effectiveness? Angle of attack of what? Of what? I didn't get you.
The moment generated by the lift.
Which lift? Control surface lift, right. No, that's not what we said. It does what? The actual moment that control surface is supposed to give us, the real moment becomes less than if this spring was rigid. Okay, you guys remember that? See what happens is, what do a control surface does? When I would deflect this control surface here with some angle beta, it is going to add additional lift on that wing. Okay, but the bad news is the additional lift does not get added up where we want it to be. If it was added up right on the elastic axis, we are okay, right, but that is not what happens. This additional lift And remember that it's all about additional lift. It's not the total lift. Sometimes people think that control effectiveness means the wing has lost all its lift cap. No, that's not what happens. What we are saying is we provide control surfaces to do something for us. But as the speed of the wing increases, as because of the flexibility of the torsional flexibility of the wing, that's not what happens. What happens is that additional lift we are expecting somehow gets moderated. It's not what, that's not what we get. We get something less than that. Okay, we get something less than that, and as a result, we are not able to control our airplane as well as we think we should be able to. Now, on the other hand, it's not a failure, total failure. Once you know that's what's going to happen, you can take effective measures first of all. And secondly, once you go into control reversal, so what? Because then you can argue, I would simply use my control surfaces in the opposite direction to control my airplane that I've been doing before. Okay? So it's very, very important to know it. In fact, you can in fact make use of it, and I will show you some of our very recent paper where we have made use of it. And so, do not think of it as a really bad thing. Okay? It is something, if you are aware of it, you can also start to make use of it. So, the basic idea is very simple, like we discussed. When I deflect this control surface over here, the lift on the wing would increase, but the additional lift is not acting over here, it is going to act behind. Behind our hinge. Okay. So, that delta L, what it does is it reduces the angle of attack of the wing. Because it has reduced the angle of attack of the main wing, the lift acting on that main wing has gone down. Okay. So, even though the lift acting on the control surface has gone up, the lift acting on the main wing has gone down. As a result, you are not getting as much increase in lift as you thought it is. And as the speed increases, the reduction in the lift, the additional lift acting on the wing is exactly equal to the change in the increase in the lift on the control surface due to control surface. So, they balance out. Delta L becomes, net delta L becomes 0. Okay, so, as if you are not, and if you go beyond that, then it just simply reverses. Okay, so, what you were expecting. And this book is from your, this picture is from your book that you guys got. Once again, in most of these computations, you would see that we really do not care about the weight. So, I mean, it is not that we do not care about it, it does not have that much impact because it has deflected things already. So, we are saying that whatever additional thing we are studying, it is with respect to that already equilibrium which weight. This wing is already under. Okay, so that's why weight is really very rarely considered. So if you do the moment equilibrium for this system about the pivot, that becomes aerodynamic moment plus E times L equal to k theta, and the lift and the pitching moment. We have used this formula many times. Q is 1/2 rho v square S C L. The moment is Q S coefficient of moment around the aerodynamic center into quad C. If beta is not equal to 0, the effective camber of the airfoil changes, right? That is what beta, that is what control surface does. They change the effective camber of the wing, and as a result you get additional lift, right? So, we can write the C L now as C L, slope of C L curve with respect to alpha times alpha plus the additional lift we are getting due to beta, and that also is represented the same way, partial C L with respect to, this is what C L alpha means, partial C L over partial alpha. Okay, so, this is slope of C L alpha curve. C L beta is the slope of C L beta curve. Okay. And this also changes, now I cannot claim that C m will not change because that beta is, I mean, is the aerodynamic center does not give me the luxury I had before that I can ignore this part. I cannot do that now anymore. So, C m beta is there. Okay. So the now the thing about angle of attack is once again same as was in the case of divergence. You provide some rigid angle of attack from your side, you say that this is my angle of attack, but that is not what you are going to get. Because of the torsional flexibility of the wing, you get an additional angle of attack because the wing has twisted. Make sense? Okay, so you have some angle of attack already, now you have applied this control surface, as a result the angle of attack has changed. It just so turns out theta would come out to be negative, but when we do the math we are going to put a plus theta. Cm beta is less than 0, airfoil is assumed symmetric, Cm 0 is 0. Okay. Then we substitute equation 2 and 3 in equation 1 and we use equation 4 and 5 to get theta, and theta comes out to be this. Okay. So, theta comes out to be, if you substitute everything in these equations we had before, this would be your change in the angle of attack of the main wing because you have deflected the control surface. So, it is more or less exactly same what we had for divergence part, the only part difference is this beta term part. Okay, because earlier you did not have beta. So because of beta the numerator has changed, but the denominator is still same what you had before, and k is the torsional stiffness of that spring. And then you can find divergence, we did that. Okay, this is something we did for that case, so let us not go there. Okay. And lift is okay. So aileron reversal occurs when, what needs to happen? Do not look at this right now, just you guys told me actually what happens when the reversal takes place. dl becomes 0, right, or dl over d beta becomes 0. That means if you give more beta it is not going to do anything for you. So you find the value of partial of l with respect to beta and this is what we get. So partial l over partial beta comes out to be 0. That condition is the numerator is 0. So k c l beta plus q s c c m beta c r alpha equal to 0. So reversal speed is given by this relation. So it is proportional to torsional spring stiffness. If spring stiffness is higher we are in good shape. It is proportional to C L beta, partial C L over partial beta would increase the control reversal, but it depends on C M. If C M beta is small then also you can get higher Q R, and if as before if you have a higher value of C L alpha that would reduce Q R, but if you have a lower value of C L alpha that would increase. Now you can represent this in terms of QD. Okay, so because we know that K over S C L alpha can be written as QD into E, so we do that, and now the QR can be written as a function of QD. It's coming out to be negative because CM beta is always negative. Okay, so actual number would be positive. So the thing that you also want to notice is QR and QD are related to each other. If you increase the divergence speed, QR should increase. But be careful. I'm making this statement for a section model. This really is not true when we go to swept back wings. For swept back wing, divergence becomes better, but control effectiveness becomes bad as we as sweep angle changes. So yes, swept back wings do not diverge, but they can lose control reverse control effectiveness rather early than the straight wings do. Okay, so we substitute in the expression for L in terms of both QR and QD, the lift expressions become QS CL alpha alpha R plus CL beta These are just very simple calculations. And then we define a ratio called partial L partial beta elastic, rate of change of lift for the elastic wing divided by rate of change of lift for the rigid wing. That is a very common way to express control effectiveness, whether it is for ailerons or for elevators or any kind of control surface. This is how we express them. What is the value for the elastic case and what would have been the value for the rigid case, and that ratio is called control effectiveness. Okay. And it comes out to be 1 minus q over q r 1 minus q over q d. If the aileron attached to airfoil in figure is considered to be flexible, then beta would have a rigid and an elastic part. What that means is, let's suppose there was also another spring attached even here. Okay. So you have a elastic part and a rotational spring with spring constant k beta would be considered at the hinge line of location. So this is in a slightly more involved case. That the first case was, we assumed that when we applied that when we deflected this at a certain angle beta, it is going to stay there. Okay. What we are considering now is, if this was not, if there was a rotational spring here also, when I apply the lift over here, what would happen? It's gonna resist that. Okay. So now we are bringing that flexibility in, which we did not do before. So you have beta B is beta rigid plus beta elastic. So we just added one more term now. Where is it? Yep. Well, so far it's the same part we had before. Okay. But when we go to beta, we would add beta R and beta elastic. Now you need two equations, because one equilibrium about the main hinge, one equilibrium about the where the aileron is connected to the wing. So one about the elastic axis is as before, nothing changes. Okay, I mean it's everything same except beta would be beta plus E plus beta R. Okay, but it really still sees the same beta. And then you have another equation about m of h, and then you write both those equations in matrix form, and this is what you get: alpha and beta unknowns. Alpha is the angle of attack you would get, beta is the angle of attack aileron, and on the right hand side you have k theta and k beta into beta. And now you can solve these two equations. Any questions up to this point? All we are really doing is we are revisiting the same equation, except that last time I did not have to write this equation. Now I am bringing in that additional equation also, that what happens at the hinge where the aileron is connected to the main wing. So we get these two equations. Substitute for alpha, alpha r plus theta. Substitute for beta, beta r plus b beta elastic, and keep all the things that are elastic on the left hand side, keep everything which is not elastic, which is rigid, on the right hand side. Any questions? The coefficient of q, okay, that's a well known thing, that whatever we multiply q with, we call them aerodynamic influence coefficient. So this whole thing, whichever is multiplying with q over here, this whole matrix over here is called the aerodynamic influence coefficient matrix. And we will revisit this when we go to divergence of swept back wings again. Any questions up to this point? So we combine all the Q terms together, and this is our K times theta into beta epsilon. We can take this on to the other side and bring everything Q related also onto that side and equate it to equated this to Q r, or we can divide both sides by minus sign. So, this becomes plus, this becomes minus. Everything on the right hand side is known to you, okay. Everything on the right hand side is known to you, and you want to find what is your elastic angle of attack, what is your elastic angle, additional angle of control reverse control angle due to elasticity. This now is, you can again think of what, when would this theta and beta e would become very large. You put the determinant of them equal to 0 and you can solve for theta and beta, okay. So, for q less than q divergence, you get lift equal to this, and L r you get equal to this. That is the rigid lift, that is the actual elastic lift you get. And control reversal occurs when L over L r goes to 0. Okay. So that's how we study control reversal. Again, it can be studied from section model, and the key equation really you have to worry about is this eta. Eta equal to 1 minus q over q r, 1 minus q over q d, and you can get your q r from this condition over here. This is your q r. This is your q r. I think it's described rather well in the book you guys have. Let me see what page it is on. ? 136. Yep. Okay. This basically is taken from page 136 of this book that you guys have. So, I want you to read this paragraph from Thinking Unconventionally, read that paragraph. Especially this line about it also may have important implications for the design of highly maneuverable aircraft. That's how they get them, because once the you get into control reversal, you can get really very large value of additional lift. Except that you have to convert lift it into the opposite direction. Why that happens? Why do you think once the control goes into control reversal, you can get lot of lift than you will ever get with the control surface alone, although it is in the opposite direction, but you can get lot of additional lift that you want, large due to what? No, then that's not what happens. You get lot of lift. Yeah, because of torsion, right? The wing would deflect in the opposite direction, but you have crossed the limit on which wing's additional lift is more than what aileron is doing. It's just that it's in the opposite direction than what you thought aileron would do. But if let's say on the right wing, I want additional lift, lot of additional lift for a. I want to really roll the aircraft very fast, like you do for fighter airplanes, right? You want very large lift. But if all I have is a small this aileron over here, that additional lift is only because of aileron. When I cross the reversal speed, the additional reduction, or I should not say additional, the reduction on the wing lift is equal to the increase on the aileron. Everybody agrees? Let's suppose now I've gone into control reversal. Okay, I've gone into control reversal speed. I suddenly now, instead of deflecting it downward, I reverse it and move it upward. Okay, and it's more than that angle at which reversal took place. I mean, it's at that speed. I'm sorry. So what do you think would happen? Even though the aileron is in the opposite direction, it is trying. It is if it the wing was rigid, it would have reduced the lift on the wing. Did I confuse you guys already? No? Okay. So I really want to increase the lift a lot. So if everything was perfect, I would have done my aileron down. But I'm flying more than the speed of control reversal. So if I put it up, in real life, in everything, if everything was rigid, I would have reduced the lift on the wing. But now I'm not reducing the lift on the wing. I am increasing the lift. But look how much area I have for the wing. Okay, so I can get so the curve that you see of control this eta. Even though it becomes negative, it becomes pretty large. You will never get at when okay. Let's see, when Q is 0, eta is what? For Q equal to 0, 1. Okay. Now put Q over. Let's now put Q equal to 2 QR. And let's say QR is and QD is pretty large. So the idea is you can get more than one, the magnitude. It can get no, it can even get more than minus one. See, that's the beauty of this relation is, and once it goes into control reversal, eta can even become the magnitude would be it would be negative number, but the magnitude could be pretty large. Okay, it could go even up to 2, and that's what fighters use. So instead of deflecting your control surface in the downward direction to get higher lift on one side and lower lift on the other side, you fly beyond control reversal speed, but use the control surfaces in the opposite direction, because then you are using, you can produce a lot more lift than aileron would ever give you, use of ailerons. Okay. So that's what this sentence is all about. I mean, this sentence that it also may have important implications for the design of highly maneuverable aircraft is that theoretically speaking, in fact, I'm sure fighter airplane use it. They won't tell it to you, but I'm sure they use it, because there is no other way to get such a large maneuverability. Because you have to somehow tremendously increase the lift on that wing, and the only thing that would let us do that is the flexibility of the wing. Okay, because flexibility of the wing can give me high angle of attack, but control reversal tells me it's in the opposite direction to what I am applying. So So why don't I apply in the opposite direction, get opposite of opposite, which is what I want, right? Negative of negative is plus. So that's how you can increase, you can have lot of lift on one side by using the flexibility. Essentially what you are doing is you are using the flexibility of the wing, and to twist the wing, what you are using the control surface not as much as to increase the lift on one side, you are using the control surface to deflect the wing, to rotate the wing. It's the same way. I think they on the back of the rotor they would have a small flap, but they instead of deflecting it downward to get more lift on one flap, they would put it on the other side so the rotor develops more lift. Same concept. So the whole idea is you need to start thinking about flexibility is not bad. We tend to think that, okay. But flexibility can be our friend if we know how to make use of it, because the thing that it does to us is it gives us the surface area of the wing. That's tremendous area I have, okay. If even a small tiny change in angle of attack of the wing can give me a lot more lift than some additional lift on aileron would ever do. And guess what? This is exactly what we did. And if you guys get some time, I want you to read this paper. I want you to, it is going to come out in, I think it has already come out in Journal of Aircraft. I don't know why I did not bring the actual copy of Journal of Aircraft paper. No, this is a different one, I'm sorry. This is a different one. This one. Nope. Huh? I thought I brought that paper for you guys. I have to get it back. This is a paper we will talk a little bit about tomorrow when we talk about flutter of transonic wings. I think I did not bring that paper. I'll ask Dr. Sunny to get it up for us and. Sunny, can we get a paper from Journal of Aircraft? I think it came last year. Rick Malik, myself, and Dr. Schatz. It's on raked wingtips. What we did was we worked with the Boeing company. At the end of the truss brace, we work on truss brace wing a lot. We put a small control surface, which can go back and forth, okay. So it was just at the tip, instead of going up and down, it could go front or back, okay. And we'll get that paper pretty soon and show it to you today. And we were able to increase the control effectiveness by doing that. And we were also able to increase the flutter speed by doing that. I thought that's the paper I brought it, but I think I brought a different paper. I think I brought a different paper. I was going to show that to you guys. Okay, so they have given us 5 minutes warning. So let's stop here and come back and spend some more time on. I really want to go over that how to calculate divergence speed of non-uniform swept back wings. Okay. That's a real capability I want to leave you guys with, not just simple textbook stuff about straight wings. Okay, so that took me long time to develop those set of notes, and I did it for you guys. You are the first one to use them.